Hi and welcome. Today we start our discussion of one of the most important theories that have been experimentally confirmed with impressive precision, which is quantum electrodynamics. Okay, what is quantum electrodynamics? Quantum electrodynamics is the theory of the interactions between charged particles and a massless force. Okay, so this is usually abbreviated with QED, and this is the theory of charged particles plus a massless force, which is a theory that by now we know quite well, because one of the examples that we saw in the previous lectures was precisely the discussion of how consistent interactions between massless photons and charged particles could be written. Okay, so in nature, the charged particles that we know are all fermions. So this the theory that the QED applied to nature is the spinor QED, okay, which whose Lagrangian takes the following form. So there is the kinetic term for the photon, which is the usual kinetic term. Then there is the kinetic term for the fermions. Let me change a bit the notation. So let me consider one fermion and let me call generically this fermion electron. So as it is customary in particle physics, we usually denote the field, the quantum field that can create one particle with the name of the particle. Okay, so the field, the quantum spinor field that creates the electron, I will call simply E. So this is now my quantum. Okay, this is a simplification in the notation, and we will see that in the standard model, when we have many fermions around, it will be very good to save us headaches trying to understand which fermions we're talking about. Okay, so from now on, I will always call the particle, the field that is associated with the particle, with the symbol and the name of the particle. Okay. So the kinetic term is simply given by the slash minus the electron mass E. And then we said that there is the interaction between the massless photon and the electron, which can be written in the following way. It is linear in the photon. There is the electron current. And then here, there is the gauge coupling that we call G in the past lectures. So now let me give it finally its proper name. So this is the electric charge, okay? And I write the electric charge in this form. So there is the proper electric charge, E. And then there is Q, which is the electric charge in units of the electron electric charge, okay? Which I know it's it seems a bit convoluted, but it's simply expressing something very simple. It is customary to express all electric charges based on the electric charge of the electron, okay, taking positive. So for instance, for the electron, Q is gonna be equal to minus one, okay? For an up-type quark, Q is gonna be equal to 2/3. For a down-type quark, it's gonna be equal to minus 1/3. Okay, so we split, we factorize the coupling into something which is universal and is associated one-to-one with the photon, which is the electric charge strength, if you want, and something which is specific to the particle that we are talking about, and is this Q, okay? Now, there is a more compact way of writing this Lagrangian, which is the following. You see that this slash, if we open it up, it is actually a gamma mu d mu. So you see that there are two operators in this Lagrangian that involve the gamma mu matrices, this one and this one. So let's try to put them together and let's see what happens. So the photokinetic term doesn't change. So this remains like this. Now, this term can be written in the following way. That is E bar. So let me put here a gamma mu. Then here I have a factor of I from here, d mu, this one. And then I need to put plus E q And then I close this operator with if. And of course, I have the master, which is this one. Okay. So if we once we factorize this factor of E, what we get is the following expression. So let me put the factor of E here. I need to multiply by minus here, by minus I here to compensate for this factor of I that I'm factorizing. This object, you see that it can be interpreted as a modification of the usual derivative, and it is called a covariant derivative, okay, of the electron. So why this derivative defined like this is called covariant will be clearer later on, okay? I will show you what covariant means. For the moment, for us, it is just a compact way of writing the electron kinetic term and the electron interactions with the massless photon. Okay, so there is, for the moment, it seems that there is no deeper meaning to this covariant derivative. Actually, once we write things in this covariant derivative, we can make contact with the approach which is usually used in the literature to introduce this theory, okay, which is called the gauge principle. So in my approach, what we did was to observe that the massless photon cannot be a four vector. And whenever we Lattice transform a massless photon, we also have implicitly a gauge transformation. And we get this Lagrangian simply requiring invariance under the extended Lattice transformation that includes also the gauge transformation. Traditionally, or if you want, in many of the books, there is another path which is followed, which is the following path. You remember that this Lagrangian has a global U1 invariance. This is the invariance, the continuous invariance, or the continuous symmetry, if you want, that allowed us to compute this Noether theorem, right? And the invariance was under this transformation here. Okay, so this is the exponential now, and this is the electron. Now, the alternative way to get immediately to this expression goes under the name of gauge principle. And the gauge principle states the form. Let's take this invariance, which is the invariance that allow us to construct the current, and let's promote it from a global invariance in which this alpha is a constant to a local invariance in which the alpha parameter depends actually on the position. Okay, so this is a E of X, and for any space-time point, the electron field transforms with a different phase. Okay, so this is a local transformation because it may vary point by point in space-time. Now, what happens to this Lagrangian? Is this Lagrangian still invariant under this local transformation? We know that it is invariant under the global transformation. But what changes when we try to make this alpha of X local? Okay. So you see that the thing that changes appears here in this derivative. Because let's analyze this term. Okay, so let's focus on this term. When I apply this transformation, this local transformation to this term, what I obtain is the following. So let me write it again. So this is E bar I gamma mu d mu minus M E E. And now when I apply this transformation, this object goes into E bar. There is this phase with an opposite sign. So let me write alpha of X to remember that this is now a local transformation. Okay. Then I have I gamma mu. And here the derivative now acts on the transformed version of E, which is this one. So you see that the derivative will act once on the exponential, bringing down a factor of minus I alpha of X. So this is minus I d mu alpha of X, E to the minus I alpha of X, E of X, where this E of X stayed untouched. And then the derivative will leave this untouched and act on the electron field. So the other term which is missing here is plus I gamma mu E minus I alpha of X d mu E of X. And then I have the mass term, which is minus ME, E the minus I alpha of X E of X. Okay. And all this term is multiplied by this one. So you see now what is happening. The exponential factors cancel because all this bracket goes like e to the minus I alpha of x. This e bar transforms as e to the plus I alpha of x. So I can simply simplify these exponential factors. And I'm not losing any information. And now what I get is that the transformation of the kinetic term is E bar. I have a factor of I gamma mu d mu minus mass of the electron field, which are this term and this other term. Okay. And then I'm left with an additional term, which is the novelty of having promoted alpha of x to be a local. And you see that this is simply this term plus d mu alpha of x e bar gamma mu e. So this reminds an object that we are actually very familiar with, right? Because this is precisely the term that we will get in a gauge transformation of the fold. Okay. So the common law, the usual approach, says that let's insist in making this Lagrangian invariant under this local transformation. So the simplest way to perform this action is to add a term, which is precisely the one that we wrote here. Okay, so now to make this invariant, I will add a term which is written like E Q A mu of X E bar gamma mu E. The addition of this term will make the whole Lagrangian invariant, provided the transformation of A mu under when the electron field transforms like this works in the following way. It gives me a factor of minus d mu alpha e bar gamma mu e. Okay. So from this point of view, from the point of view of the Gauge principle, we get precisely the same type of interacting Lagrangian with the linear term in mu, but the approach with which we get to this result is completely different. Because you see, we didn't take as our starting point the fact that a massless quantum field describing a spin-1 particle must have a gauge transformation. We used a different approach, which is promoting the global symmetry to a local symmetry, and then add a term here such that it cancels the additional term that we get due to the fact that now alpha of x is a local parameter. Okay. So the gauge transformation of that makes this term here invariant is the following. E of x goes into e to the minus I alpha of x e of x. And the photon field, A mu of X, shifts by this quantity, D mu alpha of X divided by QE. Okay. So in many books, this is what you see called the gauge transformation. Okay. So the gauge transformation, when you look at it from the point of view of the gauge principle, is telling you, look, you need to transform two fields. The matter field with a phase in which you are taking the global invariance and you promote it to a local invariance. And then to compensate for the local nature of this transformation, you need to admit, you need to introduce a linear coupling between the conserved current and the photon, and the photon must transform like this. Okay. So this is an alternative point of view. Now, it's not clear in this moment why we are getting the same result, or even better. It is clear why we are getting the same result in this simple case. Now, what we're going to do in the rest of this, this lecture is to show that actually this Gange principle provides a very simple way to construct theories which are Gange invariant at all orders, okay? Which is not obvious from our point of view, or even better, it's not that it is not obvious because we are constructing the theories in such a way that it is Gange invariant, but it's, it gives, it requires more work to see that the Gange invariance is there, okay? It's pretty obvious in spin or QED. We're going to see an example in 10 minutes in which it is far from obvious, and actually the Gange principle would give the right answer very easily, okay? So I didn't want to start from the Gange principle because it always looks like something mysterious why this work. So what I want to show you in this lecture is that this Gange principle in which the Gange transformation is this object, it's actually equivalent to what we have done, okay? So it's completely equivalent to requiring that our theory is invariant under a Gange transformation associated with a Lorentz transformation, okay, from our point of view. Very good. Now, before moving on, let me just observe one detail that will force us to modify slightly this transformation. So you see that the transformation of the photon, as I defined it, it has a quite unpleasant feature because it depends on the charge of the particle to which we are coupling it. Okay. This is quite annoying because suppose we consider a theory in which we have two, three, many charged fermions. So what charge should I put here to make all the terms invariant? Well, if you try to do the exercise, you can easily convince yourself that if we put here any charge referring to any specific fermion, then the other terms cannot be constructed and won't be invariant using the Gange principle. Okay. So there is a very simple solution to this problem, which is the following. I define alpha of x as the exponential exponent of this phase transformation. Okay. Now let me redefine this alpha of x in such a way that I take care, I completely eliminate the factor of q here. So this means that I take my alpha of x and I send it in alpha of x times q. Since q is a constant, you see that whenever I take derivatives, this is linear. So if I apply this transformation, this factor of q disappears from here and appears up here, okay? So this is the final form of the Gange transformation that we will consider. So each spin or field will transform with the same local factor, okay, alpha of x, times its own charge. So every or any spin or field will transform in a different way, but the photon will always transform in the same way. And if you can easily convince yourself that if you sit down, you do the exercise of using the Gange principle, for instance, in a theory of two spins with two different charges, then once you impose this invariance, the theory is Gange invariant, as we know. Okay, and the type of interactions that you will write are exactly the interactions that we will write, okay, in our approach. Excellent. So before turning to the task that I was describing you before of showing that the Gange principle actually provides us a quick way of constructing Gange invariant theories, Gange invariant theories in the sense that they are theories in which consistent Lorentz transformation of the photon can be implemented, let me spend a few minutes discussing why the covariant derivative is covariant. Okay, so why d mu e is a covariant derivative? Well, you see that covariant immediately calls the attention on the transformation properties of this object, okay? So the covariant derivative is said to be covariant because it transforms under this Gange transformation exactly as the field to which it is applied. Okay, so it will transform like these phases. So let's show this. So let's show that the covariant derivative is really covariant. So when I take d mu e and I apply a gauge transformation, so notice that from now on, I will always call this object the gauge transformation, okay? And the shift in the photon field that emerges from Lorentz transformation, we call extended Lorentz transformation. So from now on, whenever I speak about gauge transformation, I mean this transformation here. So let's apply a gauge transformation. So what happens? This d mu, if you remember, was the usual derivative minus E times, sorry, minus I times E minus the charge of the fermion times the photon field. So when I transform this combination, the only object that is transforming is the photon field, according to the definition over there. So this will become d mu minus I E cube A mu plus I Q, because a factor of E cancels with this denominator, d mu alpha. And then the electron field will transform like this. So it has a factor of E to the minus I Q alpha of X E of X. Okay. So you see that this exponential factor is almost completely transparent to this term, with the exception that there is a derivative here. And as we saw before, this derivative acts both on this exponential and on the field. Okay, so let's open up this action. So this action is given by minus I Q d mu alpha of X, which is the derivative applied to the exponential factor. And then I have times E of X. Then the derivative acts on the electron field. So I have a term which is E to the minus I Q alpha of X, d mu E of X. And then these other terms are completely transparent. They do not act on this exponential, right? So I can simply factorize it. And what I obtain is the following object. So I have this one. Then I have minus I E Q A mu plus I Q D mu alpha. And here I have a factor of E, and here I have a factor of E. Okay. So you see what's happening. This term, the first two terms in this bracket, reconstruct precisely the covariant derivative acting on the electron field. Okay. And then we have two remaining terms, which inspection shows that they are just one, the opposite of the other. Okay. So, sorry, actually, I forgot an exponential factor here, which is important. So now you see it's clear that this is equal to minus this. So they cancel between each other. And the conclusion is that the covariant derivative under a gauge transformation transforms by this exponential factor. So it is really covariant in the usual sense. So I guess if you saw, if you took in the past a course on general relativity, you should be already familiar with the idea of covariant derivatives as derivatives to which you add terms, okay, for instance, this one, in such a way that you obtain derivatives which are covariant in the general relativity and the general coordinate transformations here under the gauge transformation. Okay, so the meaning is exactly this. Very good. So now that we know why the covariant derivative is called covariant, and we saw that in the case of spin or QED, the covariant derivative combined with the gauge principle is giving us an easy way, a quick way to determine the interaction between the massless photon and the charged matter. Let's see how we can extend this and why this is true everywhere, every time. Okay, so instead of giving a general proof of this statement, I'm gonna consider another quantum electrodynamics theory, which is the quantum electrodynamics theory not of spin or particles, so not of spin one half particles, but of spin zero particles. Okay, And we're going to see in detail what we can do. So before moving to that, let me just outline what is the idea behind what I'm going to say. So we saw that if we insist under this gauge transformation, if we see that our theory is invariant under this gauge transformation, then the Lagrangian must be written in the following way. E bar I covariant derivative slash minus the electron mass E, where the covariant derivative, as we just saw, is the normal derivative corrected by the photon term. Okay. This is enough to determine the QED Lagrangian as we constructed it. There is an alternative way to check for gauge invariant symmetry, which is looking directly at the level of amplitudes. Okay, so what do I mean? You remember that this A mu can be written as a quantum field, so some integral of creation and annihilation operators of the polarization vectors, right? So here you have other terms, but the important thing is that you have polarization vectors. And we saw that from our point of view of extended Lorentz invariance, the extended Lorentz invariant transformation, or if you want, the little group transformation acting on this polarization vector, just amounted to a shift which was proportional to the momentum of the particle, right? Then there is the usual Lorentz transformation, but the piece that we call gauge transformation is simply this shift. Okay. So this means that in the Feynman rules, whenever we have external photons, we need to put factors of epsilon, right? And so we can check directly the gauge invariance of our theory, looking simply at the gauge invariance of the amplitude. So by gauge invariance of the amplitude, I mean that you take everywhere the polarization vectors, you shift them, and the physics, the amplitude, should be invariant under this shift. If the physics, or if you want, if the invariance, if the amplitude is not invariant under this shift, then your theory is not gauge invariant. Okay, so there is something fundamentally wrong with your theory, which you can try to correct. And we're going to see an example in which we will be able to correct. And at the end of the day, once you correct it, you will obtain exactly the same result as you would applying the gauge principle. Okay, so from now on, we will simply have to, once we are convinced that actually the two constructions are equivalent and the gauge principle has the advantage that it's much quicker, then we will simply look and use the gauge principle. Okay, so at the level of spin or QED, what we can check is the gauge invariance of an amplitude, for instance, for Compton scattering. Okay, so in the case of Compton scattering, we have a photon which is scattering off an electron. So this is a photon, this is an electron. There is an S channel with an electron, and then you emit an electron and you emit a photon. Okay, so let's say that this is photon E mu and this is photon E. This is entering, this is exiting, and the moment goes like this. Okay. So in the notes, you can find the detailed computation of this amplitude, and there you can prove, or you can see if you want, I suggest that you do the computation yourselves before looking at the notes. You can see the following problem. So this amplitude can be written in the following way. I have a factor of epsilon star mu. Let's say that this is momentum P2, and this is momentum P1, or momentum P2. Then I have a polarization vector epsilon mu of momentum P1. And then I have the rest of the amplitude, which is some two index tensor, which depends on the momenta of the electron fields. Okay. So I'm just sketching here. I will do in detail the computation for scalar. So what you can prove quite easily is that if you now shift this by something which is proportional to P2 mu. And you shift this by something that you that is proportional to P1 mu. So if you apply the old-fashioned gauge transformation, then gauge invariance is true only provided that this times this matrix element is equal to zero, and this times this other matrix element is equal to zero. Okay, so gauge invariance is the statement that P2 nu and mu nu must be equal to zero, and P1 mu and mu nu must be equal to zero. And if you do the explicit computation, you find that this is true. Okay, so you can explicitly check that gauge invariance is preserved also at the level of amplitudes as it should. Okay, if it were not, then our theory would be completely meaningless. Next, now we're going to see an example in which what we did fails, but there are ways to correct. Okay, so let me consider the case of SCADA QED. So let me cancel here. So we are now going to couple a massless photon to a spin 1 path, to a spin 0 path. So scalar QED which is the theory of a scalar coupled to a massless photon. Okay. So let's start as usual with the Lagrangian of the scalar. So the scalar must be complex, remember, because it must carry a non-trivial charge. So it cannot be, I cannot use a real field to describe it. So the kinetic term will be d mu phi mod squared. And then I will have the mass term, which is minus m squared mod phi squared. Okay, so this is the Lagrangian for a complex field. And now you see immediately that this Lagrangian has a global invariant, which is this one. So now alpha doesn't depend on x, okay, for the moment. Later on, we will promote it to a local transformation, but for the moment, this is simply a global parameter. Okay, so everywhere in space-time, the field phi transforms exactly the same. Now, what is the net current associated with this transformation, with this symmetry of my theory? Well, if you compute it, it's very simple. You can easily convince yourself that the net current is given by the following expression. So it's more complicated than the one that we saw in spin or 3D. Okay. It involves derivatives. And keep in mind the fact that it involves derivatives because it will play a fundamental role in 10 minutes. So very good. So now let's proceed as usual. So we know that we want to couple the massless photon to a conserved current. Netter theorem is telling us that this is a conserved current, as you can easily check also applying the for divergence here. So let's add a linear term coupling to the current. So this is I d mu by dagger phi minus phi dagger d mu phi. Okay, so this is the Lagrangian, the provisional Lagrangian that describes the interactions between a massless photon and a spin zero path. Now, the only slight complication that we encounter is that the interactions now depend on the derivative. Okay, so we need to discover how to compute the Feynman rules for this object. So computing Feynman rules of interaction that involve derivatives is not really a trivial task. Okay, there are subtleties. I'm going to ignore them completely and give you an intuitive way that gives at the end of the day the right result. Okay, but keep in mind that there are subtleties behind and hidden in what I'm saying. So how can we compute the Feynman rule? Well, you see that this Feynman rule is a Feynman rule that should involve one photon, let's say that this is a mu, and two scalar particles. By charge conservation, if I have a certain amount of charge entering here, the same amount of charge exit there, right? You know, we know that since we have a conserved current, we have a conserved charge. So let's say that I'm considering particles. So the initial particle, the entering particle, the particle that enters into the vertex, has momentum p, and the particle which is exiting from the vertex will have pf, or even better, p out, outgo. So p ingoing, and this one I will call p outgoing. Okay. So you see that I'm always talking about particles. And this is important because if you remember, the quantum field in terms of particles is the piece of the part of the quantum field that involves the creation and annihilation of particles, even better, the annihilation of particles, is the positive energy one. So here we have A of P e to the minus IPX. Okay, so there is the integral, there is the piece that takes care of the antiparticle. But since I'm just talking about particles here because of our choice of the errors, then I can just focus on this term. And for phi dagger, I have something similar, just that now I can simply focus on the A dagger P e to the plus IPX. Okay. And I can see what happens when I apply derivatives. So you see that when I apply the derivative on d mu phi dagger, I apply d mu here. So a factor of plus ip mu falls down. So this will give plus ip mu, which p? The p of the particle which is created, which is p out. So let me put here p out. And here, this derivative will act on phi, which is the destroyed particle. And when the derivative acts here, I get a factor of minus I p mu in, because I'm destroying the particle with momentum p. So this derivative here is giving me minus I p mu in. And once I've done this, I can use the usual trick of taking, of imagining the Feynman rule as a derivative. Okay, it's a derivative with respect to the fields. So what do I get? So you remember that I need to take a factor of I, and then I need to derive with respect to the fields. So I derive with respect to mu, with respect to phi dagger, with respect to phi, which now I don't have derivative, I don't have to worry about derivatives because I am in momentum space, if you want. Okay, so there are no derivatives, there are just momentum. And you see that what we are getting is the following object. So there is a factor of I, so there is a factor of G from here, there is a factor of I from here, there is a factor of I, P mu out, sorry, like this, and then I have minus minus I, P in, so it's plus I, P in, okay? So when you put all together, you see that you have I times I, which gives a minus sign, then this I is left. So I have minus I G P in plus P out. So this is the Feynman rule for this vertex. Okay. Again, let me stress there are subtleties that I'm completely ignoring, but this is the right result. So the interaction between the photon and the spin zero particle depends on the momentum of the scalar particle, okay? Which is something new. We didn't see this because this didn't happen in spin or QD. For scalar QD, we have a dependence on the momentum. So now to check for gauge invariance, I'm gonna use the amplitude methods. You can cancel this now. The only thing that I will use is this Feynman rule. So let me keep the Feynman rule. So let's compute the amplitude for Compton scattering, but not between a photon and an electron, but between a photon and a spin zero particle. Okay, so a scalar electron, if you want. So again, I'm going to consider Compton scattering. So it is the starter in between the photon, which I'm going to call E nu, with momentum P1. Then I have a scalar particle here, okay, phi, with momentum P2. Then I exchange a scalar particle here with momentum P. And then I emit a photon, A nu, with momentum Q1. And I emit another charged particle, phi, with momentum Q2. Okay. So let's write the amplitude for this one. So first of all, the first thing that we need to ask ourselves is this the only contribution? Well, actually, no, right? Because you remember that it's something that we saw when we were computing explicitly the psi to psi psi scattering, that then we can have two or more contributions to a single amplitude. What we need to do is to fix the external particles and try to connect them in all possible ways. And if you think about it, there is another way in which we can connect the lines, right? Which is this initial photon we couple to this vertex, and this initial and this final photon we couple to this vertex. Okay, so I need to exchange the role of the photons. So what I get is the following. So we have my scalar line. So this is like this, like this, like this. So this is still P2, and this is still Q2. But now the photon A mu of momentum P1 is not coupling to this vertex, but is coupling to this vertex. And the photon A mu with momentum of going Q1 is coupling to this other vertex. Okay. And these are the two possible diagrams that we have for quantum scattering. So let's give a name to this momentum. So I'm going to call this momentum Q. Okay. So let's write up here what are the relations between the momenta. So P is equal to P1 plus P2. And is also equal to Q1 plus Q2, looking at this side of the diagram. And Q is equal to what? So let's see. You see that Q, when I look at this vertex, I obtain that P2 is equal to Q plus Q1. So this means that Q must be equal to P2 minus Q1. And if instead I look at this other vertex, I see that Q plus P1 should be equal to Q2. So this means that the Q must be equal to Q2 minus P1. Okay. So let me call this diagram A, and let me call this diagram B, just to have some order. And now I'm gonna write the amplitude using the Feynman rules. Okay, the usual Feynman rules that we saw with this one. Okay, so what I need to remember is that whenever I have a scalar particle entering and another scalar particle exiting, the first one is momentum P in going there. Second one is momentum P outgoing, then I need to put the sum of the two. Okay. So let's start writing the amplitude for process A. Then the total amplitude, as usual, will be the sum of the two. Okay. So what do we get? Well, let's start from here. Okay. So from here we get this vertex, which is minus I G, and then I need to sum the momentum of the particles. So I have P plus Q2, and the Lorentz index is mu from here. Then I have a propagator. The propagator, if you remember, is I divided by P squared minus M squared, the mass of the scalar. And then I get to this vertex here, which is minus IG. And then I need to sum the momentum. So the momenta P2 plus P with index mu. Okay, just using this Feynman. Now, what about the amplitude for the second diagram? Well, it's gonna be very similar, but what's gonna change is the distribution of the momenta. Okay, so let's start from here. This vertex has minus IG. You will have Lorentz index mu. And the momentum which is entering is Q, and the momentum outgoing is Q2. So this is this. And the propagator will be the same with the Q squared instead of P squared. And now let's have a look at this other vertex. So this is minus I G. The index will be nu because it's coupled to this photon, you see. And the incoming momentum is P2, and the outgoing momentum is Q. Very good. So these are the two amplitudes that we have. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to check explicitly for gauge invariance. How? Applying our gauge transformation in the level of, I forgot to create and destroy the fault. Okay, so here in the first one, I am creating a photon mu with the momentum Q1, and I am destroying the photon mu with momentum P1, and the same thing down here. Q1, epsilon mu, P1. Okay, so now the amplitude is complete. Okay, and the total amplitude, of course, is the sum between them. So now I'm going to check explicitly gauge invariance at the level of this amplitude, applying a shift to the polarization vectors, which is proportional to the wrong momentum. Okay. If everything works, then we should obtain that whenever I shift one of the two momentum, the whole object vanishes. Okay. Let me anticipate it won't work. That's the problem. So let's do it. So let's suppose that I apply a shift to this one. Okay, so let me say that epsilon mu star of Q1 goes into epsilon mu star of Q1 plus a certain constant times Q1 mu. Okay, now the term with epsilon mu Q1 is here, it's the physical amplitude, so there is nothing we can do about it. What's going to be interesting is what happens to this term here, okay, that it should vanish. So let's see what happens. So you see that at the end of the day, everything amounts to compute the amplitude in which instead of epsilon mu, I have Q1 mu. Okay, so very good. So let's write it. So the amplitude, when I apply this, is equal to the following object. So let's see. We have two factors of minus I, which gives a minus sign. Then we have a factor of I here. So I have a minus I from here. Then let me write directly the propagator, P squared minus P squared. And now let me rearrange these two momentum dependent factors, taking into account the definition of P1. So from here, you see that we can write, for instance, we can choose either this or this, but you see that this one with the Q is a bit more convenient because it allows me to take into account also this term. So what I obtain here is Q1 plus two times Q2. So here I have Q1 plus two times Q2 with an index mu. And this other term, I do the same thing, but I just use the other one. So this is P1 plus two times P2. And this takes care of the diagram A. Now let's add directly diagram B. So again, this one will give a factor of minus I. Here I will have Q2 minus M2. Okay. Now, what about the factor of the momentum? Well, Q is equal to this or to this. So now it's a bit different because here I get two times Q2 minus P1 with a mu index. And the second one is this one. So I can write it as two times P2 minus Q1 with an index mu. Okay. And now all this must be multiplied by this factor here in which I am substituting disturb by Q1. So let me write it here. So there is an epsilon factor that I won't bother writing. And here I am, Q1. And I want to check how much this is. Okay. So how much is this object? Well, we can use kinematics at this point. Kinematics is telling me that P1 square is equal to zero because it's the square mass of the photon. So P1 square is equal to zero. And Q1 square is also equal to zero. P2 square is equal to M capital M square. It's the mass of the scalar particle. And the same is true for Q2 square. Okay. Very good. So now the only thing that we need to do is to open up this and see what's happening. Okay. So I'm gonna forget. Well, there is a factor of minus I here. Okay, so let's keep it there. Now we have 1 over P square minus capital M square. Now, when I contract this with this, you see that Q1 with Q1 gives zero because of this identity, and I'm left with 2 times Q1 times Q2, and then this other is left untouched. So this is P1 plus 2 times P2. Okay, what about the second one? Well, the second one is again plus 1 over Q square minus capital M square. Now, this Q now contracts the second term. So you see that Q1 with Q1 square is again equal to zero. So now I'm left with 2 times Q1 times P2, okay? And then the other one is left untouched. So it's like this, okay? And now what I need to do is try to contract things and simplify things as much as I can and see what happens. So let me cancel here. And let me see what happens. So I can try to simplify things, opening up this P square and this Q square. Okay, because if you remember from here, P square is equal to Q1 plus Q2 square. So this is equal to Q1 square plus Q2 square plus 2 times Q1, Q2, right? Now, Q1 square is equal to zero. So this is zero. Q2 square is equal to M square. And this is left with this. So you see that when I take P square minus M square, the factor of M square cancel, and I'm left with 2 times Q1, Q2, which is precisely this factor over here. So this factor and the denominator cancel one against the other. So I'm left with minus I P1 plus 2 times P2 mu. Okay. Now let's see the second term, which you can anticipate will work in a very similar way. Okay. So Q squared, let me write it here, is equal to P2 minus Q1. So it's P2 minus Q1 squared. So notice that I'm choosing the momenta in such a way that I have exactly the same ones that appear here. Okay. Of course, I could do the computation with this one, but then it would take much longer to see simplification. So let me simply choose this one. So this one is equal to P2 squared plus Q1 squared minus 2 times the scalar product between two, which is P2 Q1. Now, Q1 squared is equal to zero again. P2 squared is equal to capital M squared. So again, we see that in the denominator, this Q squared minus M squared cancel the factor of M squared, or the term M squared cancel, and I'm left with minus 2 times P2 times Q1, which is precisely this. So at the end of the day, what I get is a minus sign, minus sign 2 Q1 Q2 minus P1 mu. Okay, and now this I can simplify. This is simple. So you see that from here, I get minus I, so that is 2 times P1 mu plus 2 times P2 mu minus 2 times Q2 mu, right? Very good. So what is this object? Well, you see that you can identify this looking at the conservation of four momentum in this system, because the conservation of four momentum, let me write it up here, is equal to P1 plus P2 equal to Q1 plus Q2, right? So you see that apart from a factor of two that I can factorize, this is P1 plus P2 minus Q2. So it must be equal to Q1. So the final result is that this is minus 2 times I Q1 mu. So it's something which is proportional to the term that I am to the momentum that I am contracting with, but you see that this is different from zero. So this means that when I take this transformation, the amplitude that I obtain is not invalid. So my theory, as I wrote it, is not pitch invalid. Okay, which is a problem. It's a big problem, of course. We're gonna correct it. Let's check first what happens when I do the same reasoning with the Q2 here. Okay, so when you do with the Q2 mu here, so means that you're shifting the other polarization vector, you discover that the contraction again doesn't vanish, and it's equal to the following object. So let me write here that it is Q2 mu times the amplitude is going to be equal to minus 2 times I Q2 mu, which again is different from zero. And again, you see that it's proportional to the momentum to which I am contracting. Okay. So we have a problem. We have a problem because if you remember what we did, we took our extended gauge, extended Lorentz transformation. We coupled linearly the photon with a conserved current, and we obtained something which is not Pitch invariant. Although at the level of Lagrangian, we constructed things in such a way that they looked Pitch invariant. So what is happening here? What's going on? Well, what goes wrong is the following. If you remember, when we take the Noether prescription to compute the conserved current, we need to derive the Lagrangian with respect to the derivative of the field. Now, the coupling, when I do this and I compute the conserved current, that d mu phi dagger phi minus phi dagger d mu phi, I'm just taking into account the free term, the kinetic term of the scalar. But that term that I'm adding is actually contains a derivative. So that term that I am putting there to write a linear interaction between the massless photon and the conserved current, it's actually modifying the current because it contains a derivative term, okay? So this is telling us that we are not coupling the photon to the right current. Okay, whenever we try to add that interaction, we are modifying the current itself. Okay, so there are two approaches to try to solve the problem. Either we start to implement recursively or modify recursively the current until we get to something which is Gauge invariant stable, or we just look at these results and we try to understand what we need to add to the Lagrangian to make it Gauge invariant. Okay, the two approaches are completely equivalent. So let me follow the second one, just because we did all the computation in terms of the amplitude. So let me cancel this. And let's see what is the term that we need to add. So let me write Now, the total amplitude in the following. So there is an epsilon mu star Q1 and epsilon mu P1 times something that I call mu mu. Okay. And what we discover is that Q1 mu 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 is equal to minus 2 times I Q1 mu and Q2, sorry, P1. P1 mu m mu mu is equal to minus 2 times I P1 mu. So this is the result that we want. So now what we're going to do is to add something that cancel these two contributions. Okay. And then we will see what happens. So now I'm saying what I want to do is to add a new term to the amplitude, which I will call m mu, mu mu, in such a way that whenever I multiply Q1 nu by this one, I obtain plus 2 times I Q1 nu, in such a way that when I consider m tot equal to m plus m nu, you see that the two contributions completely cancel out once against the other. Okay. And the same thing must be true when I use P1 nu. So P1 nu contracted with m nu, mu nu must be equal to plus 2 times I Q, P1. P1. So how shall we write m nu? Well, we can use the Lorentz properties because we know that it must have two Lorentz indices, right? So let's write m nu, mu nu, as a linear combination of all possible terms that I can construct out of the metric tensor and of momenta Q1 and Q1. Okay. So this will be something like alpha G mu mu plus beta Q1 mu Q1 mu plus gamma P1 mu P1 mu plus delta P1 mu Q1 mu plus rho P1 mu Q1 mu. And that's it. These are all the terms that we can write. And now what I do is I contract this mu with Q1 mu and P1 mu and see what happens. So when I contract, when I contract it with Q1 mu, so I construct this object, let's see what happens. So when I consider this term, I get alpha Q1 mu, which is something that we like because it's a constant times Q1 mu, which is exactly what we were obtaining here. When I contract it here, I get zero because Q1 squared is equal to zero. So beta doesn't contribute. When I contract it here, I get something which is proportional to P1 mu, which I don't want because it's not appearing here. So this is forcing me to set gamma equal to zero. When I contract it here, I get again zero, so I can't say anything. You see that it's Q1 nu, Q1 nu. So because of this, I get zero. And when I contract it here, I get Q1 dot P1, dot P1 proportional times Q1 mu. So I have the correct Q1 mu, but now I have something in front that depends on the kinematic and it's not a constant. So I needed to discard also this term setting rho equal to zero. Okay. Now let's do the same thing. So at the end of the day, from here, this is the only term that survives, right? So you see that if I switch on alpha, beta, and delta, this one ends up correct, being the correct one, provided alpha is equal to 2 times I. Now let's do the same thing with P1. So when I contract with the first term, I get alpha P1 nu, which again is something that I like. It's a constant times P1 nu. When I contract with beta, I get something that I really do not like because you see that this is proportional to Q1 nu, which is not appearing here. So this is forcing me to set beta equal to zero. What about delta? Well, delta, you see that it's still there because P1 times P1 is zero because it's an unshared photon. And so this is the only contribution. So you see that at the end of the day, just constructing all possible terms, we are left with just two possibilities. The m nu must either be proportional to g mu nu or to this combination of momentum. Okay. So which one of the two shall we select? Well, we select the one that survives in the low energy limit, because gauge invariance should be there even in very low energy limit. So this is a moment in which our EFT, effective field theory ideology, comes in our aid, because you see that alpha is dimensionless, because it's contracted with something which is dimensionless, while delta must have dimension minus two in energy, because it's contracted with two powers of momentum. So the term that survives at very low energy here is the first one. So the EFT ideology is telling me, look, if you put delta equal to zero, you can discard it simply, nothing happens. And at the end of the day, what you get out of this and you constructing in this way is something which will be gauge invariant, okay, by construction. So let's write finally what our m nu is. So m nu, well, let me cancel also this one. So m nu, mu nu must be equal to plus two times I g mu. Okay, so it's a very simple term that we need to add to our amplitude to guarantee that it is gauge invariant. So now let's try to think about this as a Feynman rule. And so let's try to see what is the term that we need to add in the Lagrangian to generate this term. So it is a g, it has a g mu, so it must involve two photons, okay, which is good because we are talking about processes of two photons and nothing else. So this you can easily convince yourselves that can be derived by from this object here. I should have kept the factors of g square, because keeping the factor of g square, you would see that from here we have g square a mu square phi minus phi. Okay, this is the term that gives rise to this Feynman. This factor of two comes to the, from the fact that I am derived two times with respect to the same particle. Okay, so that's the factor of two. Factor of E is the same one. I'm missing a factor of missing this factor of G square here simply because I didn't keep it in my computation. But if you do things properly, you discover that this is here. Okay. So we are finally in a position to compute. So let's go back to our Lagrangian now. So let's leave behind this amplitude stuff. So the Lagrangian of scalar QED was minus 1/4 f mu nu square plus phi d mu phi dag d mu phi minus m square phi dag phi. Then there was the coupling to the photon, which was I g a mu d mu phi dag phi minus phi dag d mu phi. And then I need to add this new term to be to ensure that there is gauge invariance. So plus g square a mu square phi dag phi. So what does this bias say? Well, now we are sure that this is gauge invariant because we constructed the missing term to reconstruct the gauge invariant. What's funny from here, what's interesting from here, is that you can start rearranging the terms with the derivatives and the photon. And if you do so, you discover the following interesting thing, that this Lagrangian can be written in the following way. Plus d mu phi minus I g e mu phi mod square minus m square
find out your fire.
So you see that at the end of the day, the approach that we took was not the smartest one, because we are obtaining back the covariant derivative. Okay. But now we know why the covariant derivative works. So covariant derivative is the practical way to obtain a gauge invariant theory. So the theory is invariant not only because I'm coupling the photon to a conserved current, but also the level of amplitudes, as I explicitly checked. And you see that it's much simpler to do this, because you just take the derivative, you promote it to a covariant derivative, and you obtain something that now we are convinced is a theory which respects Gauge invariant. Very good. So for today, that's all. Next time, we continue with the QED. But we're going to take a small detour first, talking about anomalies. Once more, thanks for the attention, and see you next time.